Welcome back, everybody, and welcome to the last session of the 2016 Strengthening Disability Advocacy Conference. Well, we all know that there are still many barriers that people with disabilities are forced to overcome every day, and these barriers prevent them from being fully included in society, and they're social, legislative, and cultural hurdles that continue to promote exclusion rather than inclusion. So we already have some legal instruments such as the Disability Discrimination Act and the Victorian Charter, which advocates use to defend the rights of people with disability, that should go some way to improving the situation. So why are they not as effective as they could be? Will the NDIS fill the gap? And what still needs to happen to shift behaviours, attitudes and assumptions towards people with disabilities? I'm pleased to welcome Tricia Maloney, who will facilitate this discussion. Tricia is a consultant, public speaker, mentor and coach, and has an undergraduate degree majoring in anthropology and criminology. Her advocacy areas of interest are wide-ranging and include merit-based employment in the not-for-profit, government and for-profit sectors, access to services, including the NDIS, access to justice and health, and ending violence against women with disabilities. What does Tricia do in her spare time? She doesn't have any. So we would like to welcome Tricia Maloney.
Last time I walked onto a stage, I thought I won't use my crutches and I nearly fell off it. So I thought this time perhaps I should use my crutches. So thank you everybody for coming along. It's been a great, great day and we've had some really vigorous discussions. And so now this is the last session. Wow. And what a great lot of people we've got in the room. And it's great to see so many activists that I haven't seen for a while along here as well. So human rights is a really big issue, and it's a really big issue for all of us, or we wouldn't be here. And it's a really big issue for the people that I've got beside me here. So let me introduce them to you. I have, if I can find who I have, let me see. I have Professor Keith McVilley on my left, on the far left here. Keith is a PhD, he's a registered clinical psychologist and the Foundation Professor Fellow for Disability and Social Inclusion in the School of Social and Political Sciences at the University of Melbourne. His work addresses the translation of research into policy and practice with a focus on promoting the well-being and community inclusion of people with multiple and complex disability experiences. His work reflects the centrality of relationships of well-being. Much of Keith's research is conducted in applied settings, working directly with people with disabilities, families and service providers. So thank you, Keith. On my far right, so I'm obviously doing this in a formulated way, I have Alistair McEwen, and he's the Australia's Disability Discrimination Commissioner, and he commenced the role in August 2016. And I know that there are many people in the disability community who welcome the appointment of a new Disability Discrimination Commissioner. So thank you for being here. Alistair's educational background is in arts, law and business administration. Following his undergraduate studies in Adelaide, he spent time in Vancouver, Canada, pursuing postgraduate studies. Prior to moving to Sydney to commence as a consultant with Accenture, a global management and IT consulting company, he worked as associate to the Honourable Justice John Van Dusser at the Federal Court. He has a strong background in working in the non-profit organisations. He was the Executive Director of Community Legal Centres New South Wales, the peak body for community legal centres. Other roles included CEO of People with Disability Australia and Manager of the Australian Centre for Disability Law. Now, who else do we have up here on stage with me? Somebody else. We have Sharon Greenick, who is on my left, who's an old friend of mine. Well, she's not old, I'm the old bit. She's a friend of mine from a long time ago. Sharon is the Program Manager of the Empowering Women's Program at Women with Disabilities Victoria. She has worked for many years in community development in various capacities, but always in the field of diversity, including case management, residential and respite care, policy development, housing, education, training and employment. Sharon helped establish and was the first coordinator of DARU, who are the organisers of today. And that's where I first met Sharon many years ago. At Women with Disabilities Victoria, she was a member of the project management team that oversaw the Voices Against Violence research project, a cross-sector partnership with the Office of the Public Advocate and the Domestic Violence Resource Centre. She has a Master's in Human Services and Public Policy and has completed two research reports, the accommodation needs for people with Huntington's disease and Housing for Life, planning for accessible and adaptable housing in Victoria. So thank you, Sharon. And now we have the Director of Commissioner's Office at Victorian Equal Opportunity and Human Resource Rights Commission. So on my right, I have Catherine Dixon. Catherine has 17 years' experience in legal policy and management roles in both the public and private sector with a focus on anti-discrimination law and human rights issue. Catherine has also worked as a special counsel, human rights and managing principal solicitor, human rights in the Victorian Government Solicitor's Office, manager human rights unit within the Department of Justice and manager of legal policy and services with the Department for Victorian Communities, Aboriginal Affairs Victoria. Now, so now we've got the formal part over. We get into the meaty, nitty-gritty part of what we have. And what I did was I put forward a series of questions and then sent them out to people because I really hate putting people on the spot despite my tweets. So that's what I do in my spare time. I tweet. I do not try to set people up. Are people being mean to me? George? All right. Okay. We okay now?
Take it easy.
Yeah, okay, let's get on with this. So it's obviously I'm amongst friends and it's the end of the day. I have a question for Alistair. We have all of these instruments which we've talked about. We've got human rights, we've got the CRPD, we've got the Disability Act, and we've got the Disability Discrimination Act. In filling the role of the re-established Disability Discrimination Commissioner, can you strengthen social change for our rights in an NDIS environment?
Well, first of all, I'd just like to say thank you so much, Tricia. I'd also like to thank all of you and everybody out there for a very warm welcome, particularly when I've just been appointed in this new position. I must admit I've been completely overwhelmed by the reactions out there by the general public, and I'm certainly very privileged and enthusiastic about my appointment. And my aim is to develop, build on the the previous work that Graham Innes did, my predecessor, and really wanting to build on that. So recognising Susan Ryan additionally for her outstanding work, and I know that she had a difficult time because of the two portfolios, age and disability. So I certainly look forward to working with you further into the future, and thank you for that warm welcome. To respond to that question, I mean, Tricia, how much time do we actually have? So I'd like to start off with a bit of a story. So first of all, 3 years ago, when the bill was being passed with regards to the NDIS through Parliament, there was a lot of discussion taking place, and it became very clear that there was bipartisan support, but actually there was tripartisan support. So we had the ALP, the Liberals and the Greens as well. So it was very important to recognise the support of all of those three parties and use the word tripartisan support rather than bipartisan support. And it's great that we had that support to ensure that the support for NDIS would be so much stronger and much more robust. Anyway, I divert a little bit, but just going back to that story, so in relation to the newspaper story I saw, somebody wrote a letter to the editor and it actually said, why is the Prime Minister at the time, which was Julia Gillard, trying to rush this through? And some people felt outraged because for so long, people with disabilities have been oppressed, They've been treated with abuse, violence, they've been killed, neglected, whatever words or terminology you'd like to use. That had been occurring for so many years, and there was outrage about this process in this letter, and I guess that really demonstrated where the issue lay. In terms of changing attitude out there, we need to have a conversation about attitude and the general public's point of view of people with disabilities. So, you know, why should we have waited any longer? You know, that's not right. So my role is to facilitate the change of the conversation generally throughout society. Yes, we have legislation, we have policy, but we need to have conversations to change the behaviours that exist out there. So my role is really to facilitate from government down to everybody in the community.
Thank you. Keith, question for you.
Be kind, Tricia.
Can't I always? Obviously not. The NDIS is touted as a game changer for Australians with disability, ensuring social inclusion and indeed citizenship. What role will research play in measuring the changes, and how will that be done?
Thank you, I think, for that question. George reminded me in the break how I have in the past got myself into a great deal of trouble, particularly in the company of lawyers, in some of the things I've had to say. And this morning I had the benefit of sharing the podium with Ron McCallum from the Administrative Appeals Tribunal. And he was asked some questions about the NDIA, and I would like to reference Ron in my preceding words. Namely, I have no operational responsibility for the NDIA, and my comments purely come from the point of view of observation. So that's the caveat. I've made some notes though. Look, the NDIA is serious about a research agenda. It wants to know what works, why it works, how it works, and the circumstances in which particular strategies do work, because not everything works everywhere all the time. It started its research agenda with a number of focused projects, particularly to inform its planning and authorising strategies. And a couple of these projects have included the use of technology. And we've come a long way from wicker chairs with wheels sort of nailed onto the side. And technology is going to open up a whole host of opportunities for people to exercise choice and self-determination. Technology will not solve everything for everybody, but by crikeys, it's going to make a difference. Building on that research agenda around technology, the NDIA is very interested in innovations in housing. We all need a roof over our head. And where that house is, what that house looks like, can be a huge barrier to our participation in the community, or it can be a great enabler. And the NDIA are very interested to find out about how housing works and what might work best and how we might build technology into housing, but also where we might need to locate housing and what it might look like. The other main area for these focused projects has been on plan development and how might we go about the best practice processes in not simply planning for people with disabilities, but getting it right in planning with people with disabilities. And how do you enter into a conversation? It's not just about a planning session, it's truly about a conversation. The next phase of that research agenda, conscious of time, Tricia, is going to be looking at the outcome measures for participants within the scheme and for families. And I think this is a really important thing to remember, that the scheme recognises families have a critical role to play in the health and well-being of people with disabilities. And then moving forward in looking at the outcome measures for the tier two supports, the specialist services, the regional services, the remote services, and importantly, a commitment by the NDIA to developing services run by people with disabilities for people with disabilities. And they're doing a lot of preliminary work at the moment in what the outcomes might look like. In some of my discussions with the NDIA, it's become apparent that they're conscious of the burden of research on people with disabilities, yet another bloody questionnaire to complete, okay? But one of the things that I would say to you as a researcher and as somebody who is watching the NDIA do the best that it can in developing a research agenda is every opportunity you have to have a say, every questionnaire that someone gives you, every opportunity to log onto the website, to undertake an interview, please take it up. The scheme is about delivering outcomes for individuals, but the policies and the procedures are very much based on the collective, and each of us need to contribute to the collective knowledge that the NDIA has so that they can deliver good individualised services. So please participate in the research activities. Participate.
Thank you. Yeah, and I think I agree with you. Well, you know how I feel about data. The more we collect, the better understanding we can have. So please, I agree. Please fill it in. I move now to my friend Sharon. And one of the things that sometimes is missed is the gender part of the NDIS. And so Women with Disabilities have come a long way in that voices of women with disabilities are now being heard in mainstream advocacy for gender equity, to stop violence and to ensure access to health and education. So how will the NDIS provide social change for women with disabilities, particularly in as it relates to service delivery?
Thanks, Trish.
Just a small question.
Yeah, it's a really small question. And luckily for me, a lot of the other sessions have looked at this, so I can slightly reduce my talk and focus a bit on a different slant. I actually think there's a lot of legislation already in the NDIS and NDIA, and there really is a human rights obligation to eliminate sex-based discrimination in order to achieve gender equity. It's at the core of international human rights. It's how we enact on that. I think that's missing from the NDIS at the moment. Women with disabilities aren't being included in the policy making, in the planning, and in the service delivery. If we're not included all the way, how do we really make a difference? I think that's the core of things. I do see the NDIS as a real opportunity for social change, but we need a gender responsive approach to get that cultural change. We've talked a lot about choice and control today, but if you've never had it, how do you know what you've got? We talked this morning, your choice might only be rice bubbles or cornflakes. That's not real choice and control. With development of plans, we need to self-direct our plans. We have families and carers who, not in all instances, will work with the woman with a disability. They're a gatekeeper. I haven't heard that term used at all today. We've got to look at the gatekeepers. Many women with disabilities don't have access to information. Access to information is knowledge and power. If we don't get it, we're not going to be able to make a difference in our lives. I know Susan Arthur talked this morning about being a mother of a child, that it's been removed. That will continue. Many women with disabilities have their children removed. If we had access to information about antenatal, prenatal care in the mainstream, we know what to ask for. We need to train those services, the workers in those services, to be able to include us. We want to use mainstream services. We want to get away from the specialised disability services. That I think that's a really, really important crutch. We talked about being included in the mainstream. If we're not included in mainstream services, how can we ever achieve that? And I like the fact that you talk about housing. I think many more women will want to live independently in the houses. And one of the greatest things, I think, not greatest things, Ahuri looked at the services that delivered to independent housing, if a woman's living independently, they will need 5.5 hours less of service provision. with that amount, just with your NDIA package, that's fantastic. You've got 5.5 extra hours to use for something else. And we've got to recognise that having women living independently in the community means we're visible. That will mean change in mainstream. And I think that's really, really important. The one thing, just one more thing I'll add on this, if we're going to be included in the mainstream, it's not just about access. Those mainstream services, the community have to be welcoming, they have to be inclusive. And that's the real cultural change. Not just about access, because that's the easy part, the physical stuff. The real cultural change is going to mean change in the way others think, and we need to be present in that community to make that change.
Come the revolution when yeah. we're in charge. It's going to be very different, let me tell you. So now I'd like a question for you, Kate. It's not going to be too hard. Well, it might be, but it's not supposed to be, Catherine. We've had the Equal Opportunity Act and the Victorian Charter for Human Rights for a while now. How has the Commission been able to support Victorians with disabilities to challenge breaches of their rights and to challenge community attitudes?
Thanks, Tricia, for the question, and thank you very much for having me here today. So everyone hopefully knows that the Equal Opportunity and Human Rights Commission in Victoria operates under the Equal Opportunity Act, as well as the Charter of Human Rights and the Racial and Religious Tolerance Act. There are a number of different functions we have under those acts, and perhaps people here have traditionally thought of us as a complaint handling body, which is a really important part of our function. We have a dispute resolution service for people wanting to bring disability complaints and wanting to call us in relation to any inquiries. And that's a really critical service. It's free. It's the principles around it are that there's an informality. It's premised on trying to be fair. It's consent-based. It's really trying to get a quick resolution to an issue rather than having to go through a protracted legal process, and there are systemic outcomes. It's hard sometimes because the outcomes can be confidential, and it's hard to always publicise exactly how successful, I guess, all of those outcomes and services can be, but it is a really important avenue, and I constantly want to remind people to use it. So there's that service. For matters that end up going into court, we also have an intervention function. In matters that go to VCAT or in the Supreme Court, there are a number of disability cases where we've intervened and we've used our intervention function. And part of that is about trying to make sure that the law develops in a way that it's intended to best protect rights, but also where there might be an inequality between the parties to a matter. So if someone's unrepresented and we can assist by helping to put forward the human rights arguments, we will. So there's a number of cases, and I don't have time to go through them, but where we've intervened, and it's really to try and further the protections of the law itself. In terms of community attitudes, we've got also education functions, and our work in that area is to work with advocates where we can to make sure advocates can use our laws in the most effective way, but also working with duty holders. So across government, the private sector, as well as local governments and community organisations to try and make sure that there's a understanding of the obligations under the legislation we've got. We're moving into an area where we're doing less in and out training, less compliance training, and more trying to work with organisations on systemic change and what kind of strategies do we need to put in place to actually get real sustainable outcomes. Rather than just tick a box compliance, and that we're not really interested in doing that training anymore. We really want to work with organisations on strategies that embrace diversity and actually work with leaders within organisations for whole of organisation change. So that's our focus in education. And the last area I wanted to talk about, which I think some of you here will know about through our disability reference group, is our research work that we do. We've got a function under our Equal Opportunity Act, which is about research, and that is where we think that the Commission can be involved in systemic pieces of work, like really trying to understand what are the drivers to systemic discrimination. And our Disability Reference Group is a really esteemed group for us to help us know which of the areas we should be focused on and are we getting it right. And so we've done work with students with disabilities in school, being able to access their education and listening to parents in that context and advocates in that context. And we've also done work on, for example, people with disability being able to report crimes. And so, for example, we've done work as a result of that with VicPol, getting better communication guides for people to be able to report crime, but also, interestingly and recently, working with the Judicial College on a disability bench book for judges, for example, so that they can actually make the courtroom an accessible place for people with disabilities to actually enforce their rights. So I guess it's the dispute resolution, it's the intervention in court cases, our education role and our research role where I think we can add in this space.
And just off the top of my head, so you may not have the answer here, but we've talked a bit about the intersectionality. Yeah. So we have Indigenous people with disabilities, we have cold people with disabilities. So are you noticing any intersectionality there in the complaints that you receive?
Absolutely. Yeah. And the way that I guess we try and approach our work is not, because there's a number of attributes obviously under the Equal Opportunity Act, and we can't compartmentalise people in that way because that's not the reality of people's lives. And absolutely. So in the way that we approach our work is through intersectionality approach. And when we look at our complaint data, we do try and break it down to understand what kind of disability complaints are we getting, and understanding, I guess, in a more detailed way what those trends tell us. I mean, our disability is the highest area of complaint for us. Disability in employment is the biggest area, and the issues there are reasonable accommodations usually, or people being discriminated against because they've taken sick leave, for example, or they've got a workplace injury, and assumptions made about their capacity and the range of things. So yeah, we do look at intersectionality in our complaint data and our research work.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go back to Alistair now. And Australia is a signatory to the Convention of the Rights of People with Disabilities and the Optional Protocol. So how is that informing our citizenship rights under the NDS? And it'd be good then as well to talk about that intersectionality with, you know, the Convention of the Rights of Children, the Convention of the Rights of Women, and the General Human Rights Convention as well. So there is that intersectionality.
Yes, that's right. The first thing I wanted to talk about was with the CRPD, the convention. It was a rights-based convention and the first rights-based convention ever of the 21st century. So that's absolutely fantastic, and it's great to see the commitment from the Australian government. And at first, as we know, the Australian government was very reluctant to ratify the convention, but then soon came around to that and were successful ensuring that a lot of legislation from Australia was recognised as part of the convention and the changes that occurred. So we were strongly representing people with a disability. However, having said that, we need to be very clear that when we look at the NDIS and the convention and other pieces of legislation, we still have a problem of a lack of leadership and action that underpins those major documents, if you like. So the actions that drive the philosophies, the aims and the goals of the convention, the NDIS and other forms of legislation and policy. With the NDIS, I see that as one part of the conversation, and it's important that people with a disability receive their package, they receive the services they need to be able to go out and about and be part of mainstream society and actually leave the house or wherever they're living. So they need to be able to get out and about, but having said that, that's just one part of the bigger picture. We look at transport, housing, education, employment, access to property, all of these systemic barriers take place, and the NDIS isn't going to resolve those issues unless there's a strong interconnection, if you like, between those major areas. But I guess talking about intersectionality and disability, covering off on that topic, we've identified the intersectionality being a major issue and a barrier that may be difficult to resolve. So a person with a disability could be Aboriginal, they might be female, they might have a dual disability, a lack of education, and lack of voice. So there's a lot of barriers they face within that one life experience. But if you take a step back and look at that, we need to go back to the person as a whole. As we've mentioned at this conference, we are all human, like Christina said earlier on. We're all human beings. So take a step back and look at the human being and what is the barrier that's been put in place for that human being, and then we can start to progress from there. Yes, we might have children and we think the rights of the child. What can we do to ensure that the child with a disability can live a fulfilling life? Secondly, women. We've talked about women with disabilities, the barriers that they face to services, and they're not structured. You know, they need to be structured to ensure that they're included, women with disabilities. So the biggest priority for me in the next 5 years is to ensure that the person with a disability, regardless of the intersectionality, is that we bring all those topics, I guess, together to be part of the conversation.
Great answer. Thank you. Now, Keith, we've talked a little bit about this, about needing to have people with disabilities involved in the research. And I know that you've done a little bit about this already in making sure that people with disabilities have the skills to actually help conduct research. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah.
What do you need from us?
Great question. Thank you for opening up the question about research. And it's, I mean, quite often people just groan when you mention the word research. They groan even deeper and longer when you mention that you're a researcher. And there's a perception that researchers do these things in ivory towers, are very theoretically driven and are completely out of touch with reality. I dare anybody in this room to challenge someone like my valued colleague Patsy Frawley with that stereotype. She is a committed long-term researcher, committed to best practice in research, and her research and her practice is grounded in the everyday lives of people with disabilities. And most, I would say the vast majority of researchers working in the disability field would reflect that perspective. We're not theoreticians. Many of us have come out of practice. Many of us have come out of family experiences. And there are a lot of people out there conducting research who are themselves people with disabilities. When I started to think about this, I came up with a 6-point plan, Trish.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I like 12-step programs, but I realised that we didn't quite have that time
no,
this
six,
afternoon.
Six is good.
Okay, so I'll go for the 50th, sort of the 50% of it. My first plea is that people become inquisitive. Ask lots of questions, test your assumptions, and test your assumptions about what research is and who researchers are. You might be pleasantly surprised. Now, for each of these 6 points, however, there is a counterpoint for the researchers in the room, and for myself included. We need to be open to people asking us difficult questions. So there's a responsibility for researchers to respond there. The second point is to develop an understanding of the diversity of research. We talk about diversity in the community, diversity amongst disability. When you've met one researcher, you've met one researcher. Get me? Okay. But there is a diversity of approaches to research, and some research is inherently experimental. Some research is survey designed. Some research is about testing theory. Some research is about revealing the everyday experience. There are so many different approaches to research. More and more, a lot of my research is about listening to people's stories. And that's where we find out what's going on out there, what works, what doesn't, what are the barriers, what are the enablers. not so much from standardised surveys, but from listening to people's stories. So there's a variety. And the counterpoint to that is researchers need to be adaptable, and we need to be able to count things, and we also need to be able to listen to people. The third thing is find out what researchers are doing. I quite often go to conferences or go to events or meetings and people say, oh look, there's a brilliant idea for a research project, or we need to develop a tool to be able to investigate something. You know, there's not much new under the sun. There's a lot of really great research that's out there. And our problem as researchers is we haven't been good at communicating our research, of translating the knowledge into practice. And ask us questions. Find out what's already known. There might actually be solutions out there. It's just we as researchers haven't well communicated those. So challenge us to do it. And we need, as researchers, to be better at communicating our findings. The fourth point is be brave. Approach researchers. Ask us. Send us an email. Not Friday afternoon, please. Be prepared that it might take a little bit of time to get a response, but you will find many researchers would love an opportunity for a cup of coffee and to talk with you, because we want our research resource, which is very finite, to be directed towards addressing questions that are of most relevance to people. So please, make a time to talk to us. The fifth point is be prepared to participate. And that participation might be responding to surveys, signing up for focus groups, answering questionnaires, or it may well be participating in the co-design and the co-production of research. And again, I use those two terms separately and intentionally so, because some people might be interested in being a participant and having their say. Some people might be interested in co-designing the research but don't really want to get too involved in the doing. But some people might want to throw themselves whole as bolus in to being a researcher themselves. And the counterpoint to that is we as researchers need to be good at making reasonable adjustment to the research process to enable people to participate to the extent that they wish to participate. My sixth and final point is pull your finger out and become a researcher. There's a number of you sitting on your backsides in chairs this afternoon who have done that and have got a PhD. You don't always need a PhD to be a researcher. But time and time again, I come across people with the lived experience who have got the skills base, and you just need to take it to the next level. And the counterpoint to that is we in the tertiary education sector need to make reasonable adjustment and make it possible for people with that lived experience to become the investigators of that lived experience.
Thanks, Keith. So I have Keith's email address, and if you'd like to see me later, we can all start sending him emails saying, you know, include me, and I'm quite happy to take you out for a cup of coffee at some stage. I've been annoying him anyway, so it's easy. A question for Sharon. So what's missing from the NDIS scheme and the legislative instruments that you would like to see included to specifically increase the social inclusion of women with disabilities?
And I want to sign up and have a coffee as well. I want to go back to the previous question, because it's remiss of me if I don't make a statement that women with disabilities who have experienced violence are less likely to have choice and control. And the NDIS needs to, the workers and the planners need to think about that. I just want to make that clear, because I don't think I covered that.
That's a really, really important fact, that women with disabilities who have experienced violence aren't going to be in a position of control of their lives. And that's really important. Okay, so what's missing? I do think the NDIS is embedded in human rights, but there's lots of things missing. The policies, procedures, and the practices, are they gender sensitive? Have women with disabilities been involved in developing those policies and practices? The data that's being collected, is it gender disaggregated? I would suggest not. And how do we know, how do we improve the system if we don't know if it's not gender disaggregated? And that's something quite basic, I think. We don't have many gender-specific resources. I know at our organisation we've developed a fact sheet on the NDIS so women have an idea, have direction on what questions to ask when they're developing their plan. They can ask for a worker who's female. They don't necessarily have to get any worker, but services aren't telling them that. We need to make sure there's lots of gender-specific resources that women have access to, and that information has to be accessible. No good having a PDF on your website. It's got to be accessible to women with disabilities. One of the biggest things I think we need to address regarding the cultural change is having training to mainstream services and disability services. What we've done at WDV is developed a number of programs. We have our Gender and Disability Workforce Development Program, and that's working with a professional maybe in the violence space, but they're working alongside a woman with a disability. They're skilling up the mainstream workforce. And the really important part, I think, of this is we're actually creating real employment opportunities for women with disabilities. They're getting paid, they're getting skills so they can get a job. That's a really important feature of that. So you've got co-facilitators delivering this program to mainstream services. We also have a Healthy Services, Healthy Women's program, and that's delivering training to healthcare workers. A lot of women with disabilities talk about the healthcare system not meeting their needs. They're seen as a person with a disability. They don't see the woman. And a lot of women go there, go to health services for different reasons. Lots of women with disabilities don't get screened for pap smears, breast screening. Why not? We get cancer like everyone else. We don't want it, but yeah, just because we've got a disability doesn't mean we don't get those diseases as well. So why aren't we being screened at the same rates? On the other side of things, we're actually skilling up women with disabilities, and that's a really, really important feature of our work. We have the Enabling Women program, and we're delivering that around the state to empower women with disabilities to address the issues that are important to them, to give them confidence, to increase their assertiveness skills so they can ask for what they want in their plans and move on, change, address issues that are important to them in their community. We need more of that to happen. So we need training on both sides, the mainstream services, disability services, and women with disabilities themselves. The last thing I want to touch on is advocacy. I think we don't want to lose that. I looked at the legislation and the dreaded S word, the quality and safeguards. OPA, the Office of Public Advocate, is mentioned in that, but I don't see any of the other advocacy services or types of advocacy services mentioned in that. Without independent advocacy, what's going to happen to women with disabilities if they need support from elsewhere? They're not all going to be informed or able to express what they need. You do need an independent advocacy service to make sure the rights of women with disabilities are respected and applied. So we need capacity building for services for women with disabilities. We need employment. I think that's about it. The works, yeah.
Put on your Jane.
But include us in all the processes, Jane. I think that's really well said.
I think what we need is Jane talking to everybody everywhere, and then we'll all get what we need.
And so the other thing, is I'm talking here to the converted. What we need to do is have people from outside the disability community coming to our conferences, and we have a presence at their conferences. Otherwise, nothing's going to change. Because I really am preaching to the converted here. And until that happens, we are not going to be considered or be part of the mainstream.
Thank you.
I'll get off my high horse now.
Do you know what? I was supposed to be the provocative one today. I've been usurped. I'm quite
sorry.
Happy to have that happen, let me tell you. I'm supposed to be kind and moderating here, so I'll glad for you to do that. That's great. So it sort of leads to the next question for you, Catherine, which is whether there's been any increase in the number of complaints from the Barwon region with the introduction of the NDIS. So in other words, has there been any empowerment of people to actually stand up a bit, if you like? And I'd love to see if there's any gender component within that as well.
Look, it's a good question, Tricia. We actually haven't seen an increase in discrimination complaints from the Barwon region. And one of the things that people may not know is that under the Human Rights Charter, so if there's a human rights, more general human rights complaint, we actually don't, at this stage, have a dispute resolution function under the Human Rights Charter. It's something that we've advocated for when the Charter was recently reviewed. It was the 8-year review of the Charter, and that's something we're going to continue to advocate for. And in fact, the Ombudsman, who is sitting here before Deborah Glass, they do take complaints in relation to human rights, and I'm not sure whether she's seen an increase in human rights complaints from the Barwon area, but it's good because the Ombudsman also supports us having that dispute resolution function. So that's something that we're, part of our advocacy, that we're progressing. And of course, there are a lot of, there are other complaints mechanisms and avenues. So there's the Disability Services Commission and the Mental Health Complaints Commissioner, and there are other avenues. So I guess that's the short answer to your question. The longer answer, which maybe doesn't quite relate, but I thought I'd raise at this point anyway, is one of the things that we've been concerned about at the Commission and that we've been advocating is we have a human rights framework now in Victoria with the Charter that applies to the NDIA and it applies to a range of service providers, and we think that's really important to have that framework. And one of the things that we've been concerned about at the Commission is with the move to the full transition of the NDIS, that we don't lose that human rights framework and that protection. And we will lose it unless there's some pretty clear advocacy around it. So that's an area that we're really wanting to make sure we continue that advocacy and that people are aware that that's a really important thing to fight for. So that's a bit to the side of your question.
It's all relevant, and I suppose I've just got one more that anybody can feel free to jump in. And is it, how do we actually change community attitudes? How do we get to the stage where people accept us as human beings instead of the other, over there, separate? We're 20% of the population, but we're still seen as the other. And I'm opening up for anybody who wants to have a say about that one.
One of the areas I think that people with disabilities need to be on boards on a whole range of services, nothing to do with disability, it can be the zoo. So we're seen beyond our disability, that it seemed to be usual practice, that our disability is irrelevant. And until we do that, more of that, I do think we'll be on the side, we'll have this little niche where we're over here.
So some of the responsibility is with us.
Definitely.
Commenting from a research perspective, the research very clearly tells us there's no use putting an ad on television. There's no use putting a sticker on the buses or the trams that people might read. Attitude change comes when people encounter people. And it's about people getting to know people. And that's where that's where community values change. So the more that people are engaged with their communities, the more that people are involved with their communities, the more that the community is set up for encounter, personal encounter, that's where we'll get traction in terms of changing values and attitudes. And I'm not being trite here. The research tells us values and attitudes change one couple at a time.
Thank you. Sure. Some of the things that I think it's probably obvious, but in terms of the education we do with organisations, you know, some of the work that we've been doing with leaders is about actually listening and learning to the, you know, real experiences and stories of people within their own organisations and having a much better understanding of what the real experience is within that organisation, but also encouraging other staff members to actually stand up and actually pull something out if it's not right.
Very good.
And those, they seem small things, but I actually think they make a big difference to attitudes.
Definitely. Alistair.
Obviously, there's many areas that we do experience barriers, but one key area that I think we need to really look at is the judicial system. So if we're not able to give people with a disability the right, for example, to appeal a decision, for example, NDIS planning decisions, and they're wanting to appeal, then we need to ensure that we give them the resources and an avenue. And at the moment, there's limited funding for a person with a disability to appeal. So, for example, VCAT. It's limited, so there are barriers there systemically, and they're the areas we really need to look into further.
Hi, I'm Ruth Couchy. I'm a parent, and I'm sitting here with two fellow parents here. It's actually a question directed to you, Catherine, in human rights. All three of us actually have put, in the last few years, have actually put complaints to your office. And we don't feel it is actually against the Education Department, which are a very difficult department to deal with. But we don't feel that we had really anything come of it. Both, actually all of us, actually, they pulled out of conciliation. So I'm quite interested, maybe because I know you are fairly new to your job, perhaps if that is something that you're looking at, because we don't feel like we got anything really out of your department.
No, I appreciate the comment. Ruth?
I just want to add to that that it took 6 months before somebody from your organisation actually contacted me. I did go in person to follow up, and I also sent an email to the manager of the dispute resolution. And actually, I was very dissatisfied with the process. I felt it was just a postbox, really. And I didn't feel that it actually, I wasn't heard. And really, I don't think conciliation worked for me at all, any of us, because in my feeling was these organisations know the system and know how to work it and leave those unrepresented like ourselves with nowhere to go, really, except a legal process. And many of us don't have the resources or as carers to actually pursue the rights of our children with disabilities. Thanks. Yep.
Thank you. Thank you for those questions. And firstly, I guess it's sad for me to hear that you've had those experiences, and I'm sorry that you have. You know, our service is meant to be timely, and it is, but it is also based on consent. Both parties have to come to the table, and so if one party doesn't want to come to the table or isn't there genuinely, the reality is there's probably only so much we can do to progress that. And there's some fundamental, I think, limitations. I personally think with a system that does rely on a complainant to be driving systemic change, and when you're, you know, especially dealing with a big department. And so I think there's a growing recognition, I think, that a complaints-based system is a really difficult one to expect individuals to go through. And I think that we're now starting to look at different ways we can provide our service to try and address that imbalance, and why we're also trying to focus on some of our systemic work as well, because I just think individuals shouldn't be placed in that situation. So, for example, we've done and this isn't in the area of disability, but we've done some work recently with Victoria Police in relation to sexual harassment within their workforce and sex discrimination. And interestingly, out of that is a different realisation of what it actually takes for an individual to bring a sexual harassment complaint against an organisation like VicPol. And it's been a real eye-opener for, I think, them. And and us, because as a result of that, we've started to change the way that we do those conciliations and have taken a more restorative approach. But it's taken VicPol wanting to do it as well. So I really take on board what you said, and I'm sorry that those are your experiences, and I want to do better. So I'm happy to talk to you afterward as well.
Hi, my name's Lucy. My question's for Alistair, but I guess anybody who would like to respond. I guess drawing on the last session and this session and the significant evidence of violence against people with disabilities, which could in many cases be classed as torture or forced detention. And particularly in the case of people with psychosocial disability, I guess, and forced medical treatment. Do you see that if the Australian government actually ratified the optional protocol on the Convention Against Torture and were thus forced to set up a national preventative mechanism for torture that could kind of help in pulling back the curtain on maybe some of these institutional abuses that we're hearing about, do you see that would offer any additional benefit or mechanisms for addressing some of the human rights violations against people with disabilities we've heard about today?
Thank you. Could I ask where you're down there? Great. Thank you for the question. I've actually already been in discussions internally within the organisation over the last 5 weeks that I've been in this role, particularly with other commissioners, around these topics. It's early days, but my understanding is the Australian government is very committed to looking into ratifying the convention soon. We're not sure when, but the conversation is happening with the government and they're committed to exploring this further, and I'm certainly excited about that because, yes, I agree, I feel that it will resolve some of these issues that we do have, absolutely, because clearly it is violence, torture. In the word alone is violence. We've seen this occur. We've heard all the stories. We've been told clearly that violence is occurring and it is torture. So we see potential there within my role and also with the other commissioners to explore that further. But then again, the systemic barriers, there are so many, and how that has an impact is another question.
This is probably a question for the entire panel, but maybe more so for Alistair, the commissioner. There'd be no other group like people with disabilities who are segregated from their peers, like young people with disabilities are at school. The fact that we have special schools at all shows that people with disabilities are second-class citizens and separated from their peers. And I'm sure you'll agree that that's not ideal. As our commissioner, and we're very excited to have you, what will you be doing to ensure that all young people with disabilities have a right to go to school with their peers?
Thank you for that question, George. And again, I really enjoyed the Twitter you put up, the tweet you put up previously. I think your pants are dry, I hope.
No,
they're not. Ooh, okay, I don't take responsibility for that then. So already the conversation I've had internally is quite interesting, and I have noticed that there's been a lot of staff talking about their children having conversations and being more inclusive with children with a disability. So children they come across with, they might be Aboriginal, culturally diverse and so forth. So I've already noticed the internal conversations happening amongst parents and staff telling me that their children, when they attend school, are talking about the concern or the rights of other people with a disability and other children that they come into contact with. So I do hope that if we focus on the next generation and we have the younger generation thinking about that and starting those conversations, then we can ensure that change will occur because they are our future. And, obviously we're not going to be around forever, so we need to ensure that the next person can continue the conversation, and hopefully they will.
But, you know, there's a lot I'd like to say on that very topic. But I do hope that when I see, you know, my nieces and nephews and other children having conversations and being enthusiastic about discussing human rights, for example, I think the debate of marriage equality, most children are like, why are we having this discussion? So I think they're far more advanced than we are, in fact, and I think they're willing to take up the fight if we educate them and we ensure they're part of the conversation, and we need to really ensure that systemic change does occur through that process.
This question is to Keith. You just said that attitude change comes from people meeting people. In a situation where, and you also do research with people with significant, profound intellectual disabilities, how do you get people to meet people where, even in an environment like this, we were in a situation where, for example, yesterday, hardly anyone in this room actually said or acknowledged Christopher, my son here.
Yeah, say hello, Christopher.
Hi, Christopher. Hi, Christopher.
So what suggestions do you have how we can get people meeting people like Christopher?
Christopher, I hope you've met some people in the last day or two. And if you haven't met some people in the last day or two, shame on those of us in the room who have not taken the time out to meet you. We live interdependent lives, and we need to stand up for each other. We need to look for opportunities for each other. And Christopher, you need friends, friends who can stand alongside you, friends who can support you. That might start with one or two people in your lives. There's a great responsibility on them to reach out on your behalf and to foster connection. But I think there's a great responsibility on each of us to look for the person in the room who's not part of the conversation and to reach out for them. All of us in this room have had an experience in some way or form of marginalisation and discrimination. We, each of us, need to learn from that experience and to reach out to each other. That might sound a little theoretical coming from a researcher on a Friday afternoon, but basically we all need good friends to stand up for us. And Christopher, I hope you've got some good friends who will stand up for you, and we need to reach out.
Look, one of the great things about today, especially for some of us who work fairly independently, is coming together as a community. And we have people without disabilities, people with disabilities, advocates, activists, parents. And I think it's, for me, I find it very comforting, all being in the one room and sharing the same values, even if we have slightly different thoughts about how to get there, we all have the same aim, I believe. But I do want to acknowledge, following on from the last comment, one group of people with disabilities who are probably not here today, and that is those with complex, moderate to severe disabilities, who wouldn't have even had a clue that today was on, who would be relying on accommodation staff who probably can't be bothered to get them here if they wanted to come. And if they did come, wouldn't be able to speak because no one's bothered to teach them how to communicate, and just left them to rot in the corner of a classroom and now rot in the corner of a room. And I think in terms of the hierarchy of the community in a similar way to any other community, we have to recognise that all of us that are here are probably here because we're able to be, but there's a lot of people with disabilities who aren't even having the opportunity to be able to contribute, and I think we must always think of them. I want to remind people that there are evaluations on the table, and one way we can improve for the next conference is for you filling those out. You can either leave them on the table or at the front. And all of you would have received also an email with that also, so you can always fill it out online and send it back. Just a reminder also that there is a tape of the proceedings today, and in a few weeks it will be available through Daru. I really enjoyed today and seeing this mix of people that I mentioned before, and I want to thank you all for participating. I want to thank also Robin Gale, Emma King, Lauren Henley and Tricia Maloney for facilitating all the sessions today. And thank you to all the panellists as well. Thanks to the Conference Organising Committee, yay for Natasha, she's done a great job. And look, the National Australia Bank, how fabulous, what a great facility. The access, everything about it has been great. They've had volunteers here. That has just made things so much more easy for us, and we really appreciate being able to meet here. Thank you to Show Division for their partnership on all our audiovisual needs for today. And thank you to all those who have live tweeted these discussions today. Thanks to the Auslan interpreters and the attendant carers. Lastly, for all those of you who are beginning to get excited about having Keith's email address, I've got his email address. Don't get too excited, he's a very busy man. So thank you once again, everybody, for contributing to today, and hopefully we'll have a bigger and better, maybe not bigger, but you know, a fabulous opportunity to all come together next year. And in the meantime, perhaps we shouldn't wait for that, to think about how, as individuals and groups, we can come together to achieve some of the important things that we have in common by working together in between. Why haven't we signed the Convention Against Torture, for heaven's sake? There are issues that are ripe for us coming together. I'll leave you with that thought, and thank you again.